This is Steve Jewin from WrestlingObserver.com. I had a chance recently to speak with the last real man, Silas Young, who faces ACH tonight at the ROH Best in the World pay-per-view in Concord, North Carolina. Here are a few highlights from that interview.
A man's man, a real man. Not William Regal, but Silas Young. So tell everybody
how you... Not that fake crap, man. A real man.
I have to ask you this question right off the bat because for like 3 years, I didn't see you in Ring of Honor. So from 2009 to 2012, what were you doing?
Just doing smaller indie stuff. Just trying to wrestle, make a name for myself. That was about it. We know in wrestling, it's just there's so many guys trying to get a spot, and there's so many spots. I was just wrestling mainly around the Midwest area, and I had occasionally had done a few things here and there for Evolve at the time, but it was mostly just Midwest stuff.
And I think you did a couple of dark matches for WWE during that time too, right?
I believe so, yeah. But nothing that ever really materialized out of it, just matches, that's about it.
Well, let's go back even a little further than that.
I started in 2002 up in the Wisconsin area. Then in 2007, I got offered a developmental deal. I did like a week-long training thing at OVW and did a handful of house shows with them. And then about a month later, got offered a job. And then in the hiring process, I was just finishing up getting all my paperwork and stuff done. I had done all the drug and the cardiovascular testing that they do, and all that stuff had come back fine. And I was just literally in the process. I was just waiting for my passport to come in so I could send that, because you got to have a passport when you work for WWE. And I was just waiting for that to come in. And I had saw online that OVW had closed, or not closed, but the developmental deal had ended with WWE. And I thought, oh boy, that's not good news. That's where I'm supposed to be going. And the next day I got a call that said, we're not going to be going forward with your contract because of OVW closing. So I kind of got a job there, but I never really worked there, type of thing.
Damn, you had the rug pulled out from under you right at the moment that it seemed to all be coming together.
Absolutely. It was a real heartbreaker, man. It was real hard for me. I obviously never quit wrestling. It was something I always stuck with, but it was something that bothered me for a long time. But eventually you gotta get over it, move on, because, you know, life keeps going on. You gotta keep working. And I realized that, especially nowadays, maybe not so much then, but nowadays, wrestling is so hot right now. There's so many good places to work. It used to be the big two, you know, 15 years ago, it used to be only WWE and WCW, maybe ECW, but now you have WWE, you have TNA, you have Ring of Honor, you have Lucha Underground, and that's just in the States. You also have places over in Europe. There's tons of places running in Europe. WXW in Europe, I think, is on par to have like 80 shows this year. So them themselves are doing really good things. Plus there's tons of other good ones over there. Rev Pro UK, Preston City Wrestling, all tons of really good talent and a lot of work over in Europe. And then along with New Japan Pro Wrestling, it's just, there's a lot of places to work. So it's awesome right now.
Don't always rely on WWE, because they spoon feed a lot of stuff that's not very manly, I'll say. It just sometimes isn't very entertaining.
Right. And you know, a lot of it is, a lot of what we get to see is just their TV product. So a lot of the matches just aren't that long. It's not so much based on the in-ring work, whereas, you know, places like a Ring of Honor or New Japan is, you know, pretty much real heavy on the ring work, which true wrestling fans, that's what they're looking for.
Was that your goal when you first started wrestling in the independents in Wisconsin and coming up in the scene? Was you wanted to bring back that old school style of wrestling where matches mattered more than the flash and pizzazz, and you actually got to tell a story in the ring?
You know what? Actually, when I first started, I really liked. I was a little bit smaller guy, and I was really into the, you know, more of the athletic stuff. I was a huge Rob Van Dam fan, huge fan of Shawn Michaels. So I really enjoyed the athletic style of wrestling, but as the years continued and the people that I trained with and just the way I ended up wrestling, I think nowadays what I offer is the new style of wrestling with an old school spin put on it, is what I like to say.
Do you see a little bit of ACH in yourself then when you see him doing these aerial acrobatic moves and think, I used to be like that, but I learned?
Yeah, you gotta learn eventually. If you want your body to survive in this business, it can't be all aerial work.
So what really kicked off the beef? Because I've seen some tremendous stuff between the two of you talking about each other, talking to each other. It's, well, how did this all come to a head?
Well, just the idea is, you know, I talk a lot about how men aren't real men nowadays. And right now at the time, it's really popular, the whole superhero movies. I don't know whether it's DC or Marvel, or maybe both of them are putting out movies, but it's a real hot subject right now. People love it. You can't go anywhere without seeing some dude wearing a Spider-Man or a Batman t-shirt. And that's been my gripe, is that men don't wear superhero t-shirts. Men don't sit and argue about what superhero would beat what superhero in a fight.
That's fine, but as long as they're wearing a Silas Young t-shirt, though, that's okay, right? If they argue about that, who would win in a match with you.
That's just a dumb argument, because there's always only going to be one winner in that situation, and that's going to be me.
I assume then at the Best in the World, you're going to give ACH a beating for the ages and show him that, you know, it's time to man up, as the Briscoe brothers would say.
Well, you know, basically what's going to happen with ACH is he's just going to learn that it's not all fun and games. Life isn't all about video games and action hero movies. And we're going to see how far his video games get him when he steps in the ring with me at Best in the World.
Now, I want to ask you a little bit about the Beer City Bruiser. I'm sure I'm not the first person to ask you about him, but you have done some very entertaining stuff with him, and I hope there's more to come.
Oh, absolutely is.
I don't even know how to explain him to my non-wrestling friends, so how about I just let you try to give a stab at it? What would you say the Beer City Bruiser, you know, why does it work when you team with him?
The Beer City Bruiser, I mean, you look at most of the guys in Ring of Honor, and, you know, like you said before, it's really... Ring of Honor is built a lot on, athletic prowess, the athletic ability of the guys in the ring. And you look at Bruiser, and Bruiser is about probably 6'2" and probably about 300 pounds. And he is, he's not 300 pounds of muscle, but for being a guy his size, he can really move. People are always really impressed, but he is not a guy that's out there trying to impress people. He's a guy that's going to, grind someone into the mat and pound them. I mean, that's plain and simple. He's just going to beat you like a man.
Yeah, that's why I think it's great when you do stuff and he does stuff. There's a definite madness about it. It almost feels like cracking a beer and drinking it and like, hey, this is wrestling. This is man stuff. It's beer time.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, you look at the Ring of Honor locker room and he's the only guy that makes sense to be my tag partner.
I can't argue with that. You're certainly not going to tag with Dalton Castle. I know that for a fact.
Absolutely not.
That's another thing I wanted to get into, actually, is the feud with Dalton and the boys, because Dalton, he's the best word I can use for it is eccentric. What would you say?
That's a good way to put it.
So it kind of put me in your corner automatically when you guys were fighting and you wanted to teach the boys how to be men. And I'm like, yeah, Dalton's not going to teach him that. I think Silas has that responsibility here.
Yeah, I thought that whole thing that me and Dalton did together, I thought it was done really well. I thought, you know, everybody came out of it looking really good, and the fans really enjoyed it. You know, in the middle of it, I don't know if it's, I think Dave Meltzer or Brian Alvarez was talking about how it was the most entertaining storyline that was going on in wrestling at the time. And with all the wrestling that's happening in the world, to be able to, you know, have someone, you know, guys like that say that about what you're doing is pretty cool, you know, to have guys that have been around, guys that are, you know, I guess journalists in wrestling, have them really respect what you do. It's pretty cool.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I heard them say something like that either on Observer Radio or perhaps even on the Brian and Vinny show. I don't know if you checked that one out or not.
Well, that's cool, man. I always like to hear that. I think it was something really cool for the fans. And the last match that we had where we main evented the TV, that was the day after the pay-per-view. There was four TV tapings that day. We were the main event of the very last TV taping, with, you know, shows that had all the New Japan guys on it, the Young Bucks, Kenny Omega, to be able to go out there and, you know, put on a main event match after everything they had seen the last 2 days and have that crowd still be that invested. That was a really cool experience.
Well, I know you're not a big fan of comic books and superheroes, but you know they're releasing an exclusive Shockmaster figure at the San Diego Comic-Con, right?
That's pretty funny.
Yeah, I think it comes with a helmet that falls off when you take it out of the package.
That's awesome. That'd be funny if it was like the action was, not like, you know, how like they used to have ones where like you push a button and like the arms would pump or kick or something. It'd be funny if you like push a button and the head falls forward and the thing falls off its head. That's its action.
I hope that's what it is. I want to see it, but I haven't seen one yet. I assume only people at the con could get one. So I'll have to wait till somebody comes back with one and puts up a video. And, you know, just side note on that, do you think it's manly when people do these YouTube videos opening things up?
Hell no, it's not manly to do a video about opening them. It's not manly to own them or collect them. Nothing about that speaks of man.
But yeah, you're okay with your son having action figures, right? I mean, that's not a problem.
Well, that's fine, I guess. He can have them for a couple of years, yeah, but then he needs to get rid of them.
What's the cutoff point when boys really should be men? Where do you draw the line and say they have to grow up and put away childish things?
That's a good question. You know, I suppose when they're really, you know, getting to be that age, when they're starting to notice girls, maybe when they're starting to be a little bit more ashamed of some of the things they do, when they start to realize the difference between boys and girls, basically, that's kind of a sign of getting older. It doesn't really necessarily make you a man, but you're taking that next step towards it.
So maybe it's like when you're more interested in getting the girl than getting the action figure. That's the point where you cross the line.
Yeah, but the problem is you got a lot of guys who are 20, 25 years old who are still more interested in getting the action figure than getting the girl, and that's where the problem lies.
Well, it does drive the world of wrestling, though. There's a lot of people out there buying action figures and T-shirts and memorabilia of all kinds. It does put a lot of
t-shirts.
Money in a lot of pockets.
T-shirts are perfectly fine. T-shirts are perfectly fine, especially Last Real Man t-shirts. It helps you be more of a man to wear a Last Real Man t-shirt.
In fact, everybody listening to this right now should go and get one. What's the best way to do it? Do you have a pro wrestling tee store, or is it through Ring of Honor Wrestling's
absolutely.
Website? Go ahead.
I have a pro wrestling tee, so prowrestlingtees.com/Silas Young. And after Father's Day, I believe there will be a Last Real Man t-shirt available on ringofhonorwrestling.com.
Two ways to get that shirt, either go to prowrestlingtees.com/Silas Young or ringofhonorwrestling.com. But what's next after ACH? What goals do you have in mind for the future?
For the rest of the year, I'm looking to just get out, wrestle as many places as possible. In the last few months, I've been, you know, fortunate enough to get to go over and wrestle in Germany and England and Canada. So just keep traveling, keep having good matches, get to wrestle as many new places as possible. I'm getting to go to Newfoundland in about a month and a half. Never been there before, so that should be pretty cool. That's about it. Just get out, work, grind, and just meet different people, work different guys. That's the goal for me.
It's part of the reason I want to go over there for Oktoberfest. I got a couple of friends from Germany. I just want to go and drink beer and hopefully go when there's a wrestling show and we can all go get drunk and watch wrestling.
Yeah. Like I said, WXW runs a lot, so if you go over there, there's a good chance they will have a show when you're there.
All right. Well, speaking of places to be to see shows, let's get all your upcoming dates. I know the Best in the World Tour is going on. You're going to be there on June 24th, but give everybody the rundown of where they can catch The Last Real Man.
For the next couple of weeks, my shows are coming up this Saturday, the 11th, I believe it is. We will be in Hopkins, Minnesota for Ring of Honor. Sunday, June 12th, we will be in Milwaukee, Wisconsin at the Turner Hall Ballroom, also for Ring of Honor. Next Friday, the 17th, you can catch me at AAW Pro in Chicago. They're also another indie that's running some awesome shows and using tons of really good talent from all around the world. The 18th, I will be up, I believe it's Gladstone, Michigan, which is in the UP, the Upper Peninsula of Michigan. That's going to be on June 18th. The following weekend, I have Ring of Honor the 24th and 25th in North Carolina for Best in the World and the TV taping the day after that. And I believe that's all I have for dates right now. I have a few in July, but I'd have to take a look and see when they are.
To keep up with new dates as they're announced, what are the best places to go besides Last Real Man ROH on Twitter?
I was just going to say that's the best way to find anything about my career is on Twitter at Last Real Man, ROH. And like I said earlier, if you are looking for any t-shirts, prowrestlingtees.com/Silas Young.
Right. Everybody go out and pick up a t-shirt, but even more importantly, go to a live show and see the Last Real Man, Silas Young, teaching men how to be men by beating a little respect into them. What do you say? Let's get out there and see Silas Young in action. Silas, thank you so much.